Hi, I'm Dr. Ken Miller, and I'm the director of the Adult Cancer Survivorship Program at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute in Boston. And I'm very fortunate today to have with me Dr. Corey Cutler, who is the director of our Bone Marrow Transplant Survivorship Clinic as well. Corey, thanks for being with us.
Thanks very much for having me.
So you've been taking care of people who've undergone bone marrow transplant for almost a decade, and I'm interested in your broader perspective. How have things changed in the past 10 years?
Transplant has changed a lot in the last decade. We're doing much better in terms of overall outcomes and how we're doing. We've also expanded transplant to be able to now transplant older individuals using what we call reduced intensity transplantation. So that's broadened the patient population quite a bit. In addition, we've now expanded to doing things like umbilical cord blood transplantation and other alternate donor sources. So now we can offer transplant to just about everybody who requires one from a medical point of view.
Now, transplant, it sounds like, can be curative for a group of patients.
That's the goal. When we take our patients to transplantation, their goal really is to cure the malignancy for which they're being transplanted.
So let me ask you this. There's always sort of a flip side of things. There's the positive side is, you know what, hopefully people are going to live longer or we'll move beyond that disease, we'll be cured of that disease. But on the other side, what are some of the issues that people face after transplant?
So transplant is a risky endeavor. We don't undertake it lightly. Most of our patients have advanced hematologic malignancies, leukemias, or lymphomas, and they're doing transplant really as a curative process. But in the process of going through a transplant, they really do put themselves at risk for a number of other complications related sometimes specifically to the transplant and other times related to the therapies they've had prior to their transplantation.
I want to get into some examples because, you know, you're seeing people after they've had a transplant or through their transplant, after they've had a transplant. What kind of things are you looking for that may become problems?
So in the long term, our patients have really multi-system risks. So they have long-term complications in just about every organ system imaginable. You have to understand that when we deal with transplantation survivorship issues, we have to deal not only with the transplant and the problems posed by that, but also by the treatment they've had prior to their transplant to treat their malignancy. So this is sort of a double hit from a survivorship point of view. So our patients have long-term complications in cardiovascular diseases, in ocular, oral, general endocrine and reproductive health issues, bone health. There are psychosocial, nutrition, and exercise issues. It's really a multi-system process that can be affected in the long-term survivor of the after transplantation.
So let's talk about some specific examples. Someone who's had Hodgkin's disease and was treated for it, let's say with chemotherapy and radiation, and had a relapse, then had a bone marrow transplant, and it's 10 years later. What are some of the things that you'd be thinking about that they'd be at risk of in terms of their heart, and what would you do about it?
So that particular example, that's someone who's probably had chemotherapy and someone who's had radiation to the chest. And so we worry about long-term pulmonary health, risks of pulmonary fibrosis and long-term complications involving the lung, and then just as important, the cardiovascular system. So early coronary artery disease, early heart failure related to some of the chemotherapeutic agents. If this were a young woman, then there are very particular risks associated with breast cancer and irradiation of breast tissue. Mm-hmm. So the person who comes in to the transplant very much determines what the risks are at a later date.
Along those lines, I mean, we can't take the treatment back.
We can't.
It's been given. Hopefully it's been very, very effective. But what can that person do moving forward to modify their risk?
So we think that, number one, screening for long-term complications is really of paramount importance. So doing things like regular chest films, electrocardiograms, echocardiograms when necessary, mammography, these are things that we can do proactively. From the patient's point of view, healthy diet, healthy lifestyle, controlling the known risk factors for things like coronary disease and stroke and hypertension, these are all things that we tell our patients they need to pay particular attention to since they are at higher risk of developing these complications over the course of their life.
Now, bone marrow transplant can be from, or stem cell transplant, someone could be getting their own cells or they could be getting it from a donor. Let's talk about that group of people who get it from a donor. What are some of the very major issues that they may face.
So when we use a person other than the patient to donate the stem cells, we end up in a whole different category, what we call allogeneic stem cell transplantation. And there's a whole set of risks related to the immune system that most patients who have had a transplant from themselves are not exposed to. So we do have a syndrome of chronic rejection, which we call graft versus host disease, which certainly increases the risks of long-term complications and modifies them. These patients are at much higher risks for infection over the course of their lifetime, and at much higher risks for a certain other subset of problems, such as impaired oral health, a higher incidence of second cancers, particularly skin cancers and cancers in the mouth. So these are some of the extra factors that go into caring for the long-term allogeneic transplant recipient that we might not have to consider for the autologous transplant patient.
Let me ask you about, because I know you also have an ophthalmologist involved mm-hmm. in your program. What kind of problems happen with the eyes?
So a lot of our patients are taking chronic corticosteroids. Steroids are a cause of accelerated cataracts. Mm-hmm. They're also a cause of glaucoma. And so we feel that our patients need to be screened by an ophthalmologist for some of these subtler clinical findings. In addition, our patients who get high-dose radiation almost uniformly get cataracts 5 to 10 years from the time of their transplant. And these are subtle things that a patient might not recognize, because the change of a cataract is a very gradual diminution in vision. Mm-hmm. So screening for cataracts and intervening before patients lose vision is one of the things we do. Our patients also have chronic dry eye from graft versus host disease that can sometimes destroy the tear glands. They have chronic inflammation of the cornea, which can lead to vision impairment, both from dry eye and from an autoimmune or graft versus host disease effect. So there are a number, again, of conditions that occur in the eye. Most of us, as transplant physicians, are not trained well enough to deal specifically with the eye. We don't have the equipment or the training necessary to deal with it. And so we rely on specialized care for ophthalmology.
Your team has an oral health, oral medicine specialist, has a ophthalmologist. You also have a dermatologist. Well, mm-hmm. what's the reason for that?
So graft versus host disease of the skin is the most commonly affected organ in both early and late, what we call acute and chronic graft versus host disease. So lots of problems can occur in the skin. We know that our patients have a much higher rate of early and true skin cancers, so they need to be screened for these things. There's a lot of teaching that goes on with respect to sun exposure and preventing sunburn. In fact, sunburn can even trigger graft versus host disease at times. And so the dermatologist who we work with is really quite instrumental in helping out as well.
So bone marrow transplant sounds like it's a very intensive process. People are getting high doses of chemotherapy often, and they're getting oftentimes bone marrow or stem cells from someone else. After that, where are the majority of patients at in terms of their functional status, their health status in general?
So most of our patients do actually return to a very close state to normal, to where they were prior to the transplant. Of course, there are some that are left with chronic disability mm-hmm. or chronic health issues. We think that's the minority. And we know that when patients look at their own quality of life and they report on it, they do really quite well, in fact. And the majority of them do get back to a pretty good quality of life, something they're happy to have, and what they consider very, very much worth living for.
Good. Now, I've heard the expression cancer can be a teachable moment, mm-hmm. That people can make changes in their lifestyle that are positive ones. Is that something you've noticed?
Absolutely. I mean, our long-term survivors have really had a chance to reflect on the therapy they've been through. A transplant is very different than other cancer therapy. While it might be done in a few weeks, mm-hmm. the recovery period really lasts the better part of a year, sometimes longer. And during that time period, our patients learn to adapt to their new life. They're out of work. They're often socially a little bit isolated for the risks of infection. And so they learn how to get back into society, and they often reform their vision of how they want their life to be mm-hmm. when the transplant itself is done mm-hmm. a year down the road. So I think there is a fair bit of introspection mm-hmm. and a fair bit of growth among our patients who come out on the other side a lot better than they went in sometimes.
Yeah. You have a bone marrow transplant survivorship program is fairly unique.
It is.
Can you tell us about what is that and why have you put together the team the way you have?
So we do have a unique program. Our bone marrow transplant program is large enough to support a true survivorship program. What we have done is we've made this what we like to think of as one-stop shopping for our patients. Our patients come for the day, and over the course of their day, they get to see subspecialists in all of the important fields of medicine where they might have long-term complications or where there's a role to screen for these long-term complications. So over the course of the day, they'll see myself or our nurse practitioner in the clinic. They'll see an ophthalmologist, they'll see a dermatologist, they'll see a specialist in oral medicine, a nutritionist, a psychologist, mm-hmm. a whole group. And moving forward, we'll add more specialists as the demand increases.
Corey, thank you very much. It's been a great session talking about survivorship after bone marrow transplant.
Thanks very much for having me.
And I'm Dr. Ken Miller, and this has been another segment of our series on living well beyond cancer.